Morning. You guys doing all right? Come on. Hey, I'm going to invite you actually to stand with us. We are, we're going to do a song that we've done a few times here called King of My Heart. But I wanted to share a little bit of where the song came from, or like what it was written out of. And a woman by the name of Sarah McMillan, John Mark McMillan's her husband, and he wrote the song How He Loves Us. And so she wrote this song called King of My Heart. And I was looking it up the other day, like, you know, how did she write the song? Where did it come from? And I read this blog, and she shared in the Gospel of John, one of the Gospels of Jesus Christ, John 16, verse 33. And it says this, it says, I have said these things to you, that in me, Jesus, you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. I want to read it one more time. This is so rich and so powerful. It says, I have said these things to you. He's talking to his disciples. In me, you may have peace. In the world, you will have tribulation. But take heart, I have overcome the world. So right there, Jesus promises two things. He says, in the world, we will experience hard times. But if we take heart in who he is overcoming all already. On the cross, he said it was finished. Meaning sin and death is finished. Meaning that we have the access to resurrection in Jesus Christ. And so today, I want us to sing, but I want to approach it a bit differently from our minds. I want to change our minds a little bit on the foundation of why we sing sometimes. And I know we've shared this a few times that the reality is the enemy is constantly fighting for our attention. Is that if we believe in God, we also should believe that there is an enemy after us, is what the scriptures say. He's fighting for our time. He's fighting in this moment for some of us right now. He's saying to you, this is a really dumb, weird, uncomfortable moment. But Jesus wants to break through all that. And he wants us to begin to fight a different battle. See, the scriptures say that the battle is not between flesh and blood, but it's against the powers of the world. And when we come together and sing, it's like we're honestly an army rising up. And we have our God in front of us, beside us, behind us. He is fighting battles with us. And so when we sing, we're singing songs fighting against the lies of the enemy. As if we're saying, you're the king of my heart because you are so good, you are so good. That's a faith statement. That's a hope statement. The reality is, again, too, is we are here this morning because of hope. Every single one of us are hoping that God's real. A lot of us know it, a lot of us believe it, and a lot of us are coming in saying, we hope. So this is a place of hope, this is a place of joy, this is a place of love. And so we want to sing this song, and we want to believe that the power of God can draw near to us. And so I want to pray for us, and as we sing this song today, remember that it's a song of hope. You're never going to let me down. That's probably hard for some of us to sing. You've felt let down before. But he is a God that never lets us down. Because on the cross, like he promised, it was going to happen, it happened already for us. And the resurrection happened, and we believe that in this place. So let's pray together. Jesus, thank you for the cross. Thank you for your promise. Thank you for your love for us. God, I pray right now that in this place, we experience a different power, a power of the Holy Spirit. We invite you into this place, God. We are not ashamed of who you are. We want you to be our Lord. And Lord, may we pay attention to every single thing that you have for us today, from the very beginning of this service to the very end. May our focus be strong, because you speak in the big things, Jesus, and you speak in the littlest things. So may our ears be open. Let us hear you, God, and may our eyes see you. Let us see you, God. We lift our songs up to you so that you may be enthroned upon us, Jesus. We love you. In your name, amen. Let's sing together.
Sing this out. One more time. You are good. You're good. Because you have conquered, Jesus. You have overcome the world. So we just pray, God, speak to us today, deeply and personally, to each of us, God. May we put you on the throne. May you be the King of our hearts. We pray this in the amazing resurrected name of Jesus. Amen. Hey, before these guys go off, I wanted to introduce you to Abby that led us through the song. Wasn't she awesome? Abby and her husband, Josh, are new to Kensington. Josh is the worship leader over at our Shelby campus right now. And maybe you've seen them here at a midweek service singing. They're going to be joining us. So we just really want to welcome them to be part of our Kensington family. So thanks, guys. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Kensington. My name's Becky. I'm part of our campus team here at Orion. We're just so glad you're here with us today, especially if you're visiting. And we just wanted to take a minute to celebrate something cool that happened here at Orion and at our Troy campus over the weekend. We had 1,200 couples attend our vertical marriage conference. How many of you guys, were there some of you guys there? Yeah. It was an amazing weekend. Dave and Ann did some great teaching on how to help your marriage go vertical. There was all kinds of prayer happening all over this building and connection. And I really believe that God did something in marriages that is going to impact the kingdom really for generations. So if you missed the conference, but you are still interested in connecting to some resources to help you grow your marriage, or maybe you want to jump into a marriage small group, we have some new ones launching this month. We would love you to stop by the info area. We have a marriage table, and some of our team would love to help connect you in. All right, you guys, so we are only 3 weeks away from celebrating the greatest event in history. It's the beauty and power of the resurrection of Jesus. And our arts team has been planning Good Friday and Easter services, and our staff got to see a little preview of those services last week. And they have crafted a really powerful and beautiful journey that's going to start with Good Friday, where we look at and consider the price that Jesus paid when he went to the cross for us. And then it concludes Easter weekend as we celebrate together really how Jesus conquered death through his resurrection. So these services together are perfect to invite people to. In fact, if you were here for our baptism services a few weeks ago, one of the stories was someone who had been invited to a Good Friday service last year and now got baptized. So I just want to throw out kind of an encouragement and a challenge for each of us is to spend a little bit of time this week just asking God who he wants you to invite this year. And then boldly step out and do it, because you're going to be doing it under his power. And one of our values here at Kensington is intentionality. It's the idea of going out and pursuing the one. So think about who God wants you to invite and then do it. And then tickets are free. You just need them for Easter, not Good Friday. And the whole reason we do tickets if you're new is just so that we can level out services and make sure everybody has a seat. So here at Orion, we're doing 3 Good Friday services this year and then 6 Easter services, including our 7:30 a.m., which is almost sunrise, service on Sunday. And that service is going to have something special. You're going to want to go home and get tickets to that service because we have, wait for it, bacon at that service. And not just any bacon, it's bacon on a skewer. So you guys are going to want to be here for that. You can download your tickets online or even have them available on the mobile app if you want to do it that way. So just the last thing I want to mention is a couple changes to our regular service times. Our next midweek on the first week of April, we will not be having that one due to spring break. So join us back here for the third week, April 19th, midweek. We're going to have a special guest. Cody Wilson is going to be back in town to bring the message. So join us for that one. And then that same week, we will not be having a Saturday night service because we're hosting the Bethel Worship Conference. And then, let's see, what else? Oh, we're in week two of our bank series. And last night, Dave was here to do the message, and then he left for the airport. He and Am went on a much-needed vacation. So we're going to watch Dave on video today. But before we start, why don't you guys stand up, say hi to somebody around you, tell them who you're rooting for in March Madness that's still alive, okay?
Hi, my name is Roy Caldwell. Josh Korn and I were in the back talking about public speaking. Not exactly my strong point, considering for the last 30 years, my public speaking room has always been, please take care of your wait staff. So, but right now, I'd like to share a little bit. This song that Chris asked me to sing, I was more than happy to do. There's a line in this song that totally defines me, which is chaos in the corners of my mind. You take a personality with total control issues, and then you make them self-employed, you got a lot of stress and a lot of worry. So ever since, my biggest thing was trying to surrender, just to actually saying, here's the control. Once I did, a lot less worry, a lot less stress, a lot more happy. So please listen to this song and see how it relates to you. Open up my head, I know you'd find and chaos in the corners of my mind. My train of thought is racing down an old familiar track, where it's hard to tell the truth from all the lies. And imaginations have the pros and cons. Worried many times what might go wrong, only then to realize that most of what I'd feared was nothing more than fiction all along. And if I say the Holy Ghost is in my heart, and I restored every word the Father says, then why is it I struggle to relay all of the faith that's in my heart up to my head? The crazy part is how I can decide to pursue a thought or brush it to the side. No ways to go about it, but for me, the one that's right is when I take each thought a prisoner to Christ. Yeah, when I make each thought obedient to Christ. And if I say the Holy Ghost is in my heart, and I rest on every word the Father says, then why is it I struggle to relay all of the faith that's in my heart up to my head? All of the faith that's in my heart up to my head. All of the faith that's in my heart up to my head.
Faith, especially in this series as we're talking about money. I know for me, I know for most of us, it's one thing to say we trust you with our finances. It's another thing to live out our faith in real life. And so, God, I pray, even as we dive into this topic today, you would meet us right here. And, Lord, I pray you grow us deeply to a place of freedom and rest and peace in the area of our bank, our finances. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Give Roy a hand. That was great. Good job, buddy. You know, I've heard that song from the studio and the recording, and Roy did it better. Trust me, he really did. It was just so well done. And it really is a perfect song to move us into week two of this bank series, which bank, as you know from last week, is really about our money. You know, I've got bank. Hopefully you can say I got bank, which means I got money in the bank. Not everybody can say that, but when you can say that, it feels good, right? And so we're talking, okay, what's God's perspective on that? But before I jump into that, I need to say this. Saturday night crowd, say hello to Sunday morning crowd. You're looking at me like, what in the world is going on? Sunday morning right now, on video, this message is going to be shown on Sunday morning from tonight. And if you're sitting in the seats right now Sunday morning, it's already Sunday morning, so it isn't tonight. Make sense? Makes sense to me. But I thought it'd be fun for our Saturday night crowd. You guys are all going to be on video tomorrow morning with the crowd that's watching right now, right? And so you got to laugh at every joke I say really loud, you know, make it sound better. You're like a studio audience. But really, I'm not kidding. Saturday night crowd, say, I want you to give it a shout out to Sunday morning. Say hello really loud. One, two, three, hello. One, two, three. Hello! Wow. Wow, that was pretty good. So anyway, Sunday, that's from Saturday night. I'm actually in California right now, Sunday morning. After this message, I'm jumping on a plane, and Ann and I are flying to see my son, Cody, and his wife, Jenna. They're out there at Bethel Ministry School. We've never got a chance to go out there and see him. And so we're going tonight on the red eye. We're going to be showing up at his apartment at 7 a.m. your time. So it's going to be a long night. But so Sunday morning, glad I'm with you. So here we go. Bank two, which is really interesting. I was thinking, okay, what do you remember from last week? Well, last week, you know, we had a couple bank lies, like more money doesn't equal more what? Yeah, way to go. You remember from last week, more money doesn't equal more happiness. And rich people, which is all of us, if you live in America, you're in the top 5% in terms of wealth in the world. Rich people are rarely satisfied. In fact, stuff can get us. Somebody came up to me, like two or three people this week, a couple people even at the marriage conference we just did this weekend, which to me was fabulous. It was unbelievable to be able to do that for our own church. But a couple people came up and said, the one thing they remember from last week is the credit card illustration I used about Ann. Do you remember that? Saying, if Ann spent all the money I wanted to on our credit card, would she be satisfied? And I said, we'll never know. They thought that was so funny. You know, because it's never, ever going to happen. But I'll tell you something about not being satisfied with stuff. I've done that. Haven't you done that? It's like you get something and you think, I'm good. I'll never need another bigger, faster, smaller, whatever. And yet you're not. I once, a couple years ago, some of you might remember, I might have shared this story, but I started riding motorcycles when I turned 50. And the reason I got my first motorcycle at 50 is because my wife always said to me, no, you cannot get a bike. You're never riding a bike. It's too dangerous. When I turned 50, she said, you can get a bike. I'm like, okay, does that mean you don't care if I die? That's sort of what I meant, you know? So long story short, I found out in Michigan, if you want to get a better bike and a little faster bike or whatever, you sell your bikes in the spring when the sun is coming out, because everybody that wants a bike goes out and buys one off Craigslist, and you buy them in the winter because nobody wants to store one and you can get them cheap. So I did that three times. And so I'll tell you a story. I had a Honda VTX, and I put it on Craigslist, and I listed it $2,000 higher than it was worth on purpose because I didn't care if I sold it. I just wanted to see if I get any interest. And it was a really nice bike that I bought the last winter, and I couldn't ride it because my back, I had back surgery, and it's a long story, but the shocks were too tight, so I knew I had to sell it. I rode it one time, and I put it on Craigslist for more money than it was worth. I get a call from this guy. And he goes, you know, that bike's listed way too high. And I go, yeah, I know, but I just put it on and, you know, I'm going to see what happens. He goes, well, I'd like to come out and see it, but it's you got it priced too high, so I'm not even going to go look. I go, well, I got a guy coming tonight, which I did. My buddy, who wasn't going to buy it, just said he wanted to see it, so I wasn't lying. I wasn't lying, right? And he came and he said, well, if he doesn't buy it, you call me tomorrow because maybe I'll come out there, but it's way too high. I go, okay. But I said, dude, I'm not lowering the price. It's the first week on Craigslist. Maybe I'll lower it later, but I'm going to keep it. So I called him the next day and said, yeah, he didn't buy it. And he goes, I can't say what he said over the phone, but he cursed and said, okay, I'll be out there. So here's, it's classic to watch how stuff can grab your heart. And it grabbed his, and it grabs mine, and it grabs yours. He walks in my garage. I'll never forget. He walks up. He's a 50-some-year-old dude, walks in, looks in my garage, and there's a bike, and he goes, oh, bleep. And I go, is it bad? He goes, no, it's perfect. I go, is that a bad thing? He goes, yeah. I go, why? Because I want it. That's what he said. He just stood there. He goes, I want that bike. It looks just like the pictures. I go, dude, I told you. It's got the skull mirrors, and it's shiny, and it's got the pipes and all this stuff. And he goes, oh. I go, well, come on, sit on it. He goes, I'm not sitting on it. I am not making this up. It's classic. I go, well, why not? He goes, because if I sit on it, I'll buy it. I go, what do you want to do? Just look at it? He goes, yeah. And he walks around. He goes, you've got this too high. I go, I told you, I'm not going to lower it until, you know, the weekend goes by. You sure you won't take anything less? No. I go, just sit on it, man. I'm not sitting on it. Long story short, he said, I'll buy it. And I go, give me a down payment. He goes, I didn't bring any cash. I'm like, why didn't you bring any money? Because if I would have brought money, I would have bought it. That's what he said. I go, well, you bought it anyway. He goes, I know. I'll meet you tomorrow. So, or later, I drove to the bank, gave me some cash to hold on to it. And then here's the story that you might remember. The next day, he shows up to pick it up. And by the way, he paid more than he should have for a bike. Why? Because it got him. Stuff gets us. It really does. I know you're like, you're a pastor. You ripped off a guy. No, I didn't. It was a fair price, and he said yes. So anyway, he comes over the next day with his nephew, like a 19, 20-year-old kid, to test drive it because he never got on it. You know, so his nephew jumps on. He's a mechanic. He takes off out of my cul-de-sac and takes off. And I'm standing there with this guy, and about 5 minutes later, he comes back in. Some of you might remember this. His nephew rides into my driveway, and a sheriff, an Oakland County sheriff, is behind him. Anybody remember this story? This is classic. I'm like, what did this kid do? And so it's a woman, and she gets the sheriff is a woman. She gets out of the car. We're standing in my driveway, and I'm looking at the neighbors like, what do they think is going on right now? You know, with a sheriff in my driveway, and this woman gets out, and she goes, you know, do you guys know what state you're in? And we're just standing there, and she's being like pretty gruff, like, Michigan? Yeah, Michigan's a helmet state. It isn't now, but it was then, and he didn't put a helmet on. She goes, I could arrest you right now for riding. I go, oh, he was just test driving a bike. He wouldn't really, just went, I don't care. This is Michigan. I could arrest you. And then she looks in my garage, and you won't believe this, but one of my sons once stole a street sign that has his name on it. It was up there in my garage. And she goes, and I could arrest you right now for theft of property. That is state property you have in your garage. And I'm like, and we're all just standing, we're like little kids like this, and we look at her, she goes, but I'm not going to arrest you. And we're like, okay. You know why? And we're like, no. She goes, because I go to your church. And she starts laughing. I go, really? She goes, hi, I'm Jill Hickman, McLaughlin. She goes, I live in your neighborhood. I've been wanting to do this forever. She goes, oh, my gosh. And this guy's looking at me like, you're a pastor, and you sold that bike to that party? I'm like, it's all going to the Lord, brother. Anyway, I mean, that's a classic story. Jill is the greatest. She's wonderful, and she just played that trick on me, and that sign is gone, okay, just so you know. But here's the amazing thing about bank, about money. Trust me on this. People in other countries that don't have much money are not spending more than they should on motorcycles or any other possession. Why? Because stuff doesn't get them, but it gets us. Not because we have disposable income, by the way. Think about that term. That's an American term. We have disposable income, some. Try saying that in a third world country. You're like, what? You have money that's like, you can. Yeah, so that's sort of what happens. And so the whole idea last week is like, wow. We live in this country where we think more money will bring more happiness. Doesn't work. Stuff will satisfy. It never does. In fact, I don't know if you know this, but there was a study done in 2012, a Gallup poll, about the United States and happiness. I'll read it to you. It said, people in the United States should be among the happiest people on earth. We enjoy greater wealth per capita than most countries. We have more opportunity for education, medical care, home ownership, car ownership, motorcycle ownership, food availability, freedoms, and so on. but a 2012 Gallup poll ranked the United States 33rd in the world on the happiness scale. I mean, they just interviewed Americans and said, and we ended up 33rd in the world. People that have so much less than us are much more happy. Why? Because bank doesn't do it. It doesn't work, even though we think it will. And I know what you do. You and I do the same thing. We all think there's a reason. We just don't have enough bank. But when we have it, and we talked about this last week, it was like the lie is, that's not going to happen. Even though you think it will, it won't happen. And so last week, remember this verse? We went through 1 Timothy 6. I'll read it to you again just to remind you. It said, command those who are rich in this present world, who's that? Us. To do what? Not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Now, let me ask you something. I had one big truth that we said out loud together last week. Anybody think? I'm going to put it up, but anybody think they know what it was? I'll start it for you, see if you can finish it. Because I'm hoping it's something you said several times this week, because this truth is something we need to live out, because it's one thing to say. But here's how it started. I will not put my hope in riches, but what? But in him who... Yeah, you need me to put it up, don't you? Right? Hey, Saturday night crowd, you didn't look very impressive this Sunday, all right? I'm guessing Sunday. Anyway, here it is. Here's what we said last night. I will not put my hope in riches, but in him who richly provides. That is a great statement to write down, to try to live by, because we tend to put our hope migrates, it drifts toward riches, like that is where I'll find rest. And it's like, no, we learned. I'm not going to put my hope or trust or my faith in riches, because it's like, you got to be kidding me. It's so uncertain, but I'm going to put my hope and trust in him, God, who is the one who richly provides everything for our enjoyment. Now, last week I did this. I want to do it again. I really do. I thought the time to take the offering is right after we state that, because it's one thing to say, I'm not going to trust in riches, but in him who richly provides. The only way we really express that in faith, the song Roy just sang is, how do I get my faith and my heart to my head? How do I live this out? It's like, okay, it's one thing to say, it's another thing to do. So whenever we give to God or church or any charitable, it's an exercise that says, I am not trusting this. I'm giving not all of it away, some of it away. And it's an exercise to say, I'm not gonna grip this too tight. Yeah, I'm gonna hold on to it, and I should invest it, and I should save it, and I should prepare for the future, but I'm giving some back to God. So the usher's gonna come forward right now and receive the offering, because as I keep talking, because I wanna live out what we just said. And let me say this as they come forward. If you're a visitor or a guest with us, I want you to know this, and I mean it. You're our guest. You don't have to give. If you'd like to, go ahead. We're not going to stop you. If you want to give $1 million, we're not going to stop you. But we're expecting that you're like me. It's like, I'm not going to give to a place until I know the people and the mission and the place. So we understand that other people sitting around you are giving, and many of them give online, and they're not putting anything in the pouch because they've already pre-decided what to give. We're going to talk about that today, about what that really looks like. So I thought, let's take the offering at this point. And so here's what I want to do. I want to show you, and I mentioned this last week, I want to show you a cycle. I'm going to call it the crazy cycle of how we deal with money. And this is probably true in all parts of the world, but I know it's true in America and the Western parts and Canada. It's like the wealthier countries sort of have a view toward money that's really unique. And I got to tell you, I saw Andy Stanley at North Point. They did a series called Crazy Like Us on finances, about how we live this crazy mindset when it comes to money. And when I saw him sort of describe this cycle, I'm like, oh my gosh, we've got to bring that to Kensington. You've got to see this. Instead of him do it, I'm going to do it, but I'm sort of lip syncing. You know, it's like I could get an award for best screenplay copy or whatever. You know, I'm just going to lip sync what he did because it was so good. But and so it's going to come up, and if you want to try and write it down, you can, but it's like three layers, so it's going to be hard to do. But here's the thing. And I'll try and look at the screen as it does it. But when it comes to money and bank in our world, there's a word that dominates most of us. And it may not be you, but I'm guessing you've experienced this a little bit, or maybe a whole lot, and maybe a whole lot right now. The word would be worry. When it comes to money, It's like, we worry about it. What do we worry? Do I have enough? Will I have enough? Will I be able to put my kids through college? Will I be able to save for retirement? I can remember when my kids were little, I remember thinking, will I even be able to afford car insurance for them? There was one point in our life, we had five cars insured for our three sons and us. They were beater cars, but yet it was like, you worry about it, you lay in bed. Anybody? Show of hands. Anybody ever worry? Yeah, everybody worries about it. And so that sort of dominates. And so here's the amazing thing we do in America. We worry, and then guess what we do? We spend more than we make. That's just what we do. It's like this next step is like, we just spend as much as we have or actually more than we make. And it's just sort of crazy. And guess what that leads to? That leads to debt. You know, you've heard of that thing, debt? It's like we don't have enough money, so we put it in a credit card or we put it in some way, so we end up in debt. And then we end up with no margin, right? And so it's like that debt goes over to here, no margin. And then what happens when we have no margin? There's no margin. We have no wiggle room at all in our finances. So what do? We worry. And then what do we do? And I'm not making this up. We actually spend as much as we make or more. You would think we wouldn't because we're so worried about it, but we actually do, and then we end up in debt, and it goes around. And this thing is a crazy cycle. It doesn't make sense. It's like, who in the world would do that? I read an article this week that people, immigrants coming to the United States, they don't have debt, and they don't understand the American economy. It's like, why do you people do this? They're basically saying, that's crazy. And we just think that's the way the Americans live. You know, it's just the way it is. There's even commercials about this cycle. That you would never think, oh, that commercial is about this cycle, but they are. I want to show you one that you might remember. It was on TV several years ago. It's a little fuzzy even because we just took it off the internet. But watch this. This explains sort of what we do in terms of the crazy cycle. So watch this.
I'm Stanley Johnson. I've got a great family. I've got a four-bedroom house in a great community. Like my car? It's new. I even belong to the local golf club. How do I do it? I'm in debt up to my eyeballs. I can barely pay my finance charges. Somebody help me.
Yeah, you remember that commercial? And we're laughing, and yet we do it. You know, we're laughing because it's true. It's like, yeah, I am in debt up to my eyeballs, and we just keep spending more than we make. It's unbelievable. So if you go back to the chart, I told you there's three layers. Second layer is this. It's like, okay, so what do we worry about? We worry about future consumption, right? That's what we worry about future consumption. So while we're worrying about how we're gonna, you know, have enough money for future consumption, what do? We consume more than we can afford. It makes no sense. Like, we still keep going in this crazy cycle, and then you get down to debt, what do? Pop that up. We go into consumer debt. That's the term for it. Consumer debt, national debt. We got silly, crazy, stupid debt. It's all over the place. And then we have no margin for future consumption. It's like crazy. And by the way, did you see the word that's all over that thing? Consumer consumption. It's all over that. You know why? Because this whole thing is about a mindset. I love the term that Andy Stanley used. I've never heard it before. He calls this mindset the consumption assumption. What's that mean? We tend to believe that anything that comes to us financially is for us. The assumption that we're supposed to consume it. So that's consumption assumption. It's like, it came to me, whatever way I got it, working, whatever, win the lottery, whatever, I got it. Guess what it's for? It's for me. And so because of that mindset, we end up in this crazy cycle. Now here's the amazing thing. Let me ask you a question. Look up there. Do you think there's an amount of money that you could start making that would take away your worry? Like, if you made 10% more money this year, I know you're thinking, probably like me, no, that wouldn't do it. 25%, which probably isn't going to happen tomorrow when you go into, you know, going to work. You're not going to all of a sudden get a raise 25%. But most of us think there's a number that we could get to and it would change all this. But here's the truth. This isn't about money. This is a mindset that it doesn't matter how many zeros you add on to your number. The mindset has habits, and those habits go no matter how much money you make. Why do people that make double what you and I make still have debt? They don't need to have debt, but they do. They spend more money than they have, and you think, if I made double what I make, I'd never spend more, wouldn't you? So when you look up there at the first step we consume before, what's the problem there? Is that a spending problem? No, that's a self-control problem. That's not a spending problem. That's a self-control problem. It's a mindset. You go to debt. Is that a debt problem? No, that's a contentment issue. You see what I say? That is really about contentment, because if I'm content, I would never spend more money than I actually have. I would never pay interest for something that, you know this, by the way, the second you buy that, whatever it is, its value goes down, and the amount you're going to pay for it goes up. It's a crazy, crazy idea. But we do it because we're not content. Stuff doesn't satisfy. So it's not a money problem. It's a self-control problem. It's a contentment problem. And the no margin for future consumption is really a discipline problem. Now, here's the amazing thing, and this is where I believe it gets really good. This whole thing of worry and anxiety is not even about money. It's a spiritual issue. It really is. Think of this. Do you ever remember Jesus saying this? If you're really worried and anxious and can't sleep at night, just make more money and it'll go away. He didn't say that, did he? Never said that. You know why he didn't say that? Because Jesus knows better than any of us. It's not a money problem. It's a spiritual problem. In fact, some of you know what Jesus really said was, where your treasure is, there your heart will be. So if your treasure is in money and bank, you're not going to sleep at night, because your heart is tied to that. And there's no number that can get high enough for you to ever really feel peace. And I know you're just like me. You're thinking, oh, no, there is a number. If I could get $1 million a year, then guess what? I know millionaires, and maybe you do as well, and they have no more peace than you and I. And you're like, you got to be kidding me. Nope, not kidding. And trust me, you and I are no better than they are. We would have the same worry and anxiety that they have. Maybe even we grip tighter, because once you get more and more, you tend to hold it tighter and tighter. Remember I said last week, the richer Americans give less and less than the poor Americans to charity? Why? Because it starts to become our treasure, and worry is with it. See, this whole crazy cycle is a mindset that has habits. And you know what's really interesting is Jesus said, and if you're not a Christ follower today, you're just checking this out, just listen in, but if you're a Christ follower, he was speaking to you and me, and he said, that crazy cycle is really about one word. You ready? Greed. Man, it was scary he said that. He said, you're greedy, and you think every dollar that comes to you is just for you. And when you live like that, it's hard to sleep at night. And then Jesus said, there's a whole nother way to live. In fact, let me read you a story that Jesus told that, man, I'm telling you what, you talk about sort of like the rich American story in the Bible. It's found in Luke chapter 12. Some of you might have heard this one, maybe even in Sunday school, but Jesus was talking about this habit, this greed, and he said, he told them a parable. You know what a parable is? I remember one guy said, yeah, I like those preambles in the Bible. I'm like, no, it's not a preamble. It's a parable. It just means story. It's not a true story. It's a made-up story with principles or a life lesson in it. So Jesus says, he told him a parable saying, the land of a rich man produced plentiful. You know what that means? This guy's already rich, and he just got richer. You ever heard that story before? Yeah, that's the American dream story. It's like, man, I'm wealthy, and I don't think I'm wealthy, but I am, and now I'm even wealthier because his land produced more. And it says, and then he thought to himself, what shall I do, for I have nowhere to store my crops? And he said, I will do this. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. So here's what's really interesting. He's making so much, and he has so much stuff, he doesn't have room in his big house to store it. Ever heard that story? I told you last week, Americans are the only people in the world that have storage units to store our stuff that doesn't fit in our 5,000 square foot homes. By the way, I do not have a 5,000 square foot home. I know that's what you do. How big's his house? He's a pastor. No, it isn't. But that's what we do. And then, or it's like, I'm going to finish my basement because I need, that's him. And you know what he's doing? He's doing what he's always done. This isn't like the first time he got rich. He's been rich, and now he's doing better, and he's like, I'm going to do the same thing I've always done. I got to build bigger barns, bigger storage units to put my stuff in. And then it goes on to say this, and I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry. Now, is it good that he prepared for the future and laid up some things? Yeah. That's a good thing. But here's where he got messed up. He said to himself, soul, me, take care of this, prepare, relax. And he goes, because I have many years to live. Guess what he didn't know? He didn't know how many years he has, and either do you and I. We said riches last week are so uncertain. Why would we trust riches? Why would we even trust the fact that we think we're going to live another 20 years? You and I don't know if we get next week. And this guy didn't. According to the story, he said, but God said to him, very strong word, fool, this night your soul is required of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be? He ran out of time before he ran out of money. And his was the consumption assumption. It's all about him. And he never thought of blessing others. And Jesus says, I want you to understand how God thinks of this story. Fool, you've misplaced your priorities in life. And I think it's every man's story, not just this guy in the Bible. And then he goes on to say this. He said, so is the one who lays up treasure for himself. And look at this. And is not rich toward God. Now, if you're anything like me and you read a story like that and you get to the punchline, and Jesus always brought a punchline, he says, so this man misplaced everything. He didn't understand what it means to be rich toward God. You should ask this question. Okay, I better know. What does richness toward God look like? You think you know? See, I think from this story, it's pretty clear. Jesus is saying, if you want to be rich toward God, bless God's people. Like if you came up to me and said, man, I want to bless you by giving something to your kids, I'd be like, awesome. The best way you could ever bless a father is to bless his kids. It's better than, well, you could give me, anyway, it's better than, you know what I'm saying? It's like, and so it's almost like God is saying, man, you want to be rich toward God. Don't be like this guy and do the consumption assumption. It's all for me. It's like, no. Bless others with the riches that God has given us. You know, it's interesting. Last week, when we looked at 1 Timothy 6:17, I introduced you to verse 18. Remember I said next week we're going to look at this because Paul's writing to Timothy and says, command those who are rich in this world not to be arrogant or put their hope in riches, but in him who richly provides, right? And then he said, command them to what? Anybody remember? I'll read it to you because I want to show you what he said. He said, command them to do good and to be rich in good deeds and to be generous and willing to share. So he says, man, if God has blessed you with wealth, which by the way, that's all of us. We are all very, very wealthy. So God has blessed us. He says, okay, don't be arrogant. Don't put your trust in that. Put your trust in God. He says, but here's what you should do. Be rich in what? Blessing others, doing good things for others. In fact, you should be above average in that. Bless others in rich and good deeds. And then he says, and be generous and willing to share what? Your riches with others. That's how we are rich toward God. And he even ends this way. He says, in this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. What's he saying? It's not just about this time. It isn't just a temporal life. There's actually eternal consequences. And when you realize God has blessed me to be a blessing to others, I can have an impact on eternity with bank that God has given me. My own life, I can bless others and be in rich in deeds, but I also can bless others with the money God has given me. I can give some away that will impact others for the kingdom of God. You know, it's interesting. Again, we're quoting much of Andy Stanley in this series, but he had a very interesting, I hope you write this down, definition of what it means to be generous. Because Paul just said, command them to be generous. He didn't say to give, he said to be generous. And he didn't say do generous things, he said be generous. It's like a character quality. And so write this definition down, so good. He says, generous is the premeditated, calculated, designated emancipation of personal financial assets. Every word in there is chosen very clear. Generosity means premeditated. What's that mean? I thought it through beforehand. I don't just make a decision when the pouch comes by or the guy knocks on my front door and I'm like, oh, here you go. No, it's like, I thought this through. I've thought through. I'm going to pre-decide and I'm going to calculate an amount or a percentage right? And I'm going to designate it somewhere so I know where it's going. And I love the word emancipation of our personal financial assets. You know what he's saying? It's going to set me and my financial assets free. When you love to be free and be able to rest at night because you've premeditated, calculated, designated a freedom to your assets, that's what it's like. And so here's what I'll show you. And I know you know this, but I just want to remind you. God has given us meaning the church, followers of Christ, an exercise to help set us free from the bondage and the worry and the anxiety of finances, of the worry crazy cycle. You know what it is? It's an exercise called being generous with our finances. You know it as giving. In fact, I've got bank right here in my back pocket. Look at this, man. Bank. You're like, are those hundreds? No, they're $1 bills, okay? And I only have 10 of them because that's all Ann would give me. So here we go. We got 10 $1 bills. Now, I'm going to do you a math problem to show you how God created this amazing exercise that says if you just do this, you will discover a freedom in your finances you've never experienced in your life. You guys ready? It's a math problem. Here's how it works. God says to us, every time he gives us 10 of these, give one back. It's called the tithe, 10%. Let me do it again. I see your eyes are glazing over. Here we go. I know we don't like math. Every time God gives us 10 of these, okay, you get it. I'm having fun with you. But, you know, you've heard that. It's like God wants us to give one out of 10 back. Yeah. Whether these are $10 bills or $100 bills or $100,000 bills, he says, 9 of them are yours. Enjoy. Give one back as a generous releasing, premeditated, calculated, designated emancipation of your own finances. And when you do that, you will become free of the crazy money worry cycle. And I know what you're thinking. That is a big ask. Now, I'm telling you, I know. I've felt what it feels like to do that. But I also tell this. If you would go to your 5-year-old and give them $10 and say, honey, just you keep 9 and give me one back, she would probably go, you only want one? I get to keep 9? Yeah, I know it sounds crazy, but yeah, just give me one. Because really, it's my $10, but I'm going to give it to you and enjoy. But just give me one back. Not too many kids are going to go, no. I mean, some would. But most of them would be like, okay, I'll keep 9. But yet, when we hear God say that to us, we like freak out. And I know some of you are really smart. You're going, hey, dude, you're not talking about taxes. You're not talking about pre-tax, post-tax. I get it. There's government and all that in there. But the basic principle is this. Every time God blesses us, he says, don't live out the crazy, greedy cycle. You want to be free? I've created an exercise that will not only bless the world, but will even set you free. And I'll tell you, I've experienced it for many decades now. And it's a beautiful thing. But when Ann and I first started to do this, it was scary. Because if you want to know when your faith finally goes from your heart to your head and you start living it out, it's in this area. Money is the area that shows us how serious we are to truly trust God. And so I got to tell you, we're going to invite you starting today, and then next week we're going to follow up as well. But starting today, we're going to invite all of Kensington to do something we did 3 years ago. We're going to challenge you to test God in this area and do this, maybe for some of you the first time ever. And to explain that exercise, Ann and I sat down actually in our family room and shot a video to say, okay, we're going to show this to all of Kensington this weekend and next weekend to say, okay, this is the exercise, the challenge, the test we're inviting you to join us in over the next 90 days. So watch this.
Dave and Ann Wilson here, and we welcome you to our home. We're actually sitting on the couch where I have many times struggled with trusting God. One of the dominant themes of the Word of God is trust. Trusting God with every single area of our lives.
Which can be really scary because we're talking about our marriages, our future,
our kids,
our lives.
Yeah, and I tell you what, one of the hardest areas for me is money. It's been a real struggle. For many years, actually, we had many fights right here in this family room. I would lay on this couch watching TV, Ann's over there starting to rip checks out of the checkbook to pay our bills, and I would just freak out.
He would leave the room, and he would be in a bad mood for days even after I paid the bills because he was so stressed and gripped with, like, fear.
Yeah, my security for many years was tied to a number in a bank account. It wasn't really tied to trusting God. Even though I knew God would provide, I really struggled with believing that. It all came down to one word, fear.
And the thing that we've seen about fear is the more fearful I become, the more controlling I become. And it's almost like we hold on to the things that we want to control. And this is the look. Our fists are closed and we're holding on for dear life because of our fear. And God's asking us to trust him, which is so scary because it's opening our hands to him. And this is a position of both receiving and giving, because when we're like this, how can we receive from God?
Yeah, the interesting thing for me is I was like this with my life.
Oh, that's true.
And even maybe our career and future and our ministry, and yet I was like this with our money, because that was the one that got me. It had my heart. And I got to be honest, you know, I've realized, and I've said this many times at Kensington, faith is a choice. And I can remember reading Philippians 4:19, where Paul just writes these simple words, "And my God shall supply all of your needs according to the riches in Christ Jesus." And it was, you know, it was something I had taught before, and I remember just reading that one day, and I was like, do I believe this? And it was a choice that we made. I had to make myself to go from like this with my money to like, okay, I'm going to give. I'm going to obey God's word and what he says about giving back to him.
I could see it in Dave as he let go. The thing that happened was he was released from his fear. He's always tempted to take it back, but he found this freedom, and we found this freedom in our relationship even.
So I'll tell you what, when we went from this to this with our money, we experienced freedom. Mm-hmm. And that's what we want you to experience. So we are inviting you into a journey that we're calling the Whole 90. For the next 90 days, we're inviting you to join us to take the whole tithe, 10%, and give it back to God for 90 days.
Yeah, and I'm sure a lot of you have heard of the Whole 30, where it's an eating, diet, plan, cleansing thing. Well, this is the same idea of that, is you're getting control of your eating. This is kind of giving release to God of our money.
So for the next 90 days, join us and we'll give 10% back to God and we'll watch him provide. He'll take care of us. I'm not gonna say you're gonna get a new car or your basement's not gonna flood, but I can make you this promise. God is gonna meet you in a way you may never have seen him meet you before. We have seen that in our relationship with God, especially with money, as we decided to give 10%, we have seen a peace we didn't know.
Well, and there's not necessarily a change in our money per se, but there's a change in our peace and our contentment and our trust. And that has given us life and it's given us hope for our future, because our hope is in Jesus, not in our bank account.
Yeah, and I've found that I can lay on this couch while we pay bills and know that there's a God that is faithful and has met us financially and in every other way of our life. He can be trusted. And here's the amazing thing. I believe that you're gonna discover the exact same thing over the next 90 days. But let me tell you this, if you don't, if you decide to tithe to Kensington and after 90 days you decide, man, I don't think that was a good idea. I don't wanna keep doing this. We will give you your money back. We'll refund everything back that you gave to Kensington to give it back to you, because we believe you're gonna discover just what we've discovered. God is faithful, God can be trusted, and you will meet him in a way you've never met him before.
So I know that how that can come across, like, wow, this is a big challenge, it really is. It's interesting, the only time I heard somebody clap is when we said, we'll give you your money back if you want it back. It's like, somebody clap. You know, and we do mean that. And we did this, I think it was 3 or 4 years ago, as just really an exercise as a community, as a church. And I know it's individual, but it's also all of us, as many as want to participate in this. And here's what we found out 3 or 4 years ago. We got email after email from people who said, I did this, and God showed up like I've never seen him in my life. And I'm not going to say, hey, they got $1 million, they won the lottery. And we're not that, I'm not that preacher. It's not even in the Bible. But they saw God show up like Ann and I were talking about. He meets you right where we are. So the usher is going to come right now and pass out this for you to fill out right now if you want, or to take home. Ushers, come right now. Pass these out, because we're going to give you some time to actually read this through. And then as we close the service with a song, we're going to pass the pouch again. This is not a second give. Like, we didn't get enough the first time, give more. No, that is for you. If you're choosing, you can make this decision today. You rip this off and put it in and tell us what you're going to do. Some of you may need to do this. I need to think about this. I need to talk to my spouse or significant other about this. And I want to take this home and come back next week. Yeah, we'll do that as well, because we're going to have this here next week. This week and the last week of the series, we'll offer this challenge. But some of you already right now know what God's leading you to do, and so you can be able to do that. But I just want to let you know, as you get this, I mean, it explains this whole thing, just like we did 3 years ago. It tries to make it as clear as can be to answer your questions. And by the way, if you have any questions about this, email us. Email me. Email Alex Calder at our finance department and ask anything you want. But we tried to create a document that would answer all your questions. And here's what's really interesting. I think some of you know this, and I've actually done this. God says in the last book of the Old Testament to his people, the nation of Israel, he says, test me. It's the only time in the entire Bible that God says to us, test me. And guess what's in relationship to? It's to our money. He says, test me and try me. Bring the tithe in to the storehouse, the church, to the kingdom of God, and see if I don't take care of you. He says, go ahead, test me. And so we're like, let's take him at his word. Go ahead, test him for 90 days. Test him. And by the way, and I mean this, look at me. I want you to make sure you understand. I mean this. You don't have to give it to Kensington. I care less you give it to Kensington. Give it to any charity you want. It's not about Kensington. It's about God's going to set you free with an exercise he gave us to show us this can get a grip of us. When you let go of 1 out of 10, you start to find a freedom. So give it to another ministry, another church if you want. Give it to, you know, any charity you want. But if you do give it here, and we have a record of that, and you want your money back after 90 days, we can get. If you give it to the United Way, we can't give you your money back, okay? But if you give it here, we definitely can. And I would just, I'm going to pray, and we're going to sing, but I would just encourage you and challenge you to consider testing God with a premeditated, which means I'm going to pre-decide, which is calculated. It's going to be 10%, right? I'm going to designate it here or somewhere, and then I'm going to find a freedom, an emancipation in my personal financial assets that I've never experienced in my life. And I tell you, when Ann and I shot that video, we tried to be as honest as we could with you, because I've struggled with this. And I'll tell you something. What I said in that video is true. I don't lay on the couch and hear checks getting ripped out of the checkbook when Ann's paying the bills and freak out anymore. Why? Because we have more money? No. It's not about the number of zeros. I know God. And I've seen him decade after decade after decade meet us, sometimes in miraculous ways, financially and other ways, to provide all of our needs, not all of our wants, but all of our needs. He has always provided, just as the verse I quoted says. And my God, I know this verse. I've memorized this verse. Why? Because I believe this is true. Paul said, and my God, not some God, my God, who I know as my Father, he said, and my God shall, not maybe, shall supply all of your needs. How? Through Jesus. And so, man, I know this is a scary thing, and I get it. If you say, I'm out, no problem. But if you want to join in and just see what God does, and, you know, as you look at this card, I just want to make sure you saw, there's all kinds of options there. There's actually 5 options, and one of them is no thanks. No problem. That's between you and God. It's not us trying to coerce you to do that. One of them is, no, thank you. I will not give at the time. No problem. Then there's all kinds of options, whether it's I'm going to give 10% or I'm going to increase my giving by a percentage. You pick. But I would challenge you, because I've done this and I've experienced this. I would challenge you to really step out in faith and test him and trust him like never before. And I'm not kidding. Watch what God does. And again, I'm not promising you a money, truckload going to drop in on you. I am promising you this. My God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches in Christ. So let me pray, and then I'll tell you how we're going to close today. Father God, man, Lord, you know this is big. This is a scary thing. Money is one of the scariest, hardest areas of our lives to trust you. Why? Because it's got us. It's so easily where our treasure is, and our heart goes right there. And man, to think about giving some away, maybe more than we've ever given our life, Lord, you know it's scary. It's like a trust fall. We're just falling through air, and we're not sure you're going to catch us. And Lord, I know you will. You always do. And I know we have stories from last time. Hundreds of people here experienced that for the first time. So Lord, I pray for these Kensington folks that are going to take this step of faith, almost a leap of faith. God, show up like you always do. Give us stories to tell, not only our community and our church, but our kids and our grandkids, that God can be trusted in every single area, including our finances. So Lord, we trust you. Beginning today, we will no longer place our hope in riches that's so uncertain, but place our hope in you, who richly provide us with everything for our enjoyment. God, help us to become generous people. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you're anything like me, I make a lot of financial decisions based out of fear. And so we wanted to end today with my favorite song ever written for worship, man, called No Longer Slaves. And we've done it a lot here, but my hope is that it can be an anthem for us, is that as we think of a challenge like this, and as we think of a journey of walking through understanding that and trusting God with our finances, that we can look one day at everything and say, it doesn't matter how much comes in. It doesn't matter how much goes out. In the end of the day, I know that I'm yours, God. I know that you have me. You have me covered. You love me. You care for me. And we can sing that out. So let's stand up and let's sing together before we head out.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song. Deliverance from my enemies, where all my fears are gone. Come on, sing it out. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. And I'm no longer. Child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born. I am a child of God.
us be reminded of that for the rest of our lives. Not just for today, not just for tomorrow, not for this week, for the rest of our lives. We love you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Hey, before you head out, I want to remind us that those cards that you filled out today, as you're walking out, please hand those into the ushers. They're going to be holding the offering pouches out. Also, don't forget about our prayer team. These are warriors that want to pray for us and help us become children of Jesus. And the last thing is this. If you're new with us today, we're so pumped that you're here. Out in our lobby, we have some people wearing some orange shirts. It's called Starting Point. This is your first time. We want to connect with you. We hope to get you plugged in, answer any questions you have. Thanks for coming. We'll see you next week for the last week of Bank.